Hi, everybody. It's good to see you again. And we're continuing in the book of Isaiah. We're at chapter 61, and there's 66 chapters in Isaiah, so we've gotten quite far in it. And there's a lot in Isaiah 61, so I'm going to break it up into two parts. We'll go over the first part today, and we're looking at the liberty to the captives being set free. And that's really good to look at. And so we'll just look at some of the basic things that are in the chapter, and then let's look back at our time frame to see where we are within the time frame of the history, and then we'll just get right into it. Liberty to the captives, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. You see, that's a long time. And the day of vengeance of our God, that's a short time. The planting of the Lord, everlasting covenant, seed known among the Gentiles. The Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring forth before all the nations. So it's something where you see this fruitfulness coming that's happening within all the nations, not just this small area of the world and not with this small group of people, but with the whole world at large. And reminding ourselves of when this time is, of course, let's go back from David until Babylon comes in. So within that time frame, we're looking at the time of kings. So the only time that Israel was united was under Saul, David, and Solomon. And so after that, of course, Solomon was following along with these wives. He was taking wives from many places, and he started following their gods. And so that Israel got totally broken up. So you have the northern tribes of Israel, 10 tribes, and they lasted for 209 years. And so every single one of these kings of Israel, not one good king out of Israel. I tell you, you want a good king of Israel? There were none there. The only time you had a good king was Judah. The southern kingdom, which was made up of Judah and Benjamin, they actually had 8 good kings out of 20. But, you know, you can see most of these kings were bad, and it's something how the northern tribe of Israel had not one good king. So with the north not having one good king, God sent prophets to warn them, but they wouldn't listen. They killed the prophets and wouldn't listen to them. So God let Assyria come down. But the southern kingdom of Judah, they actually did listen to their prophet who God sent, Isaiah, to speak. And so he spoke to him, and Hezekiah was the king at the time, who happened to be a good king that was following what God was saying. And so God saved them at that time, and that's the time that we're at right now in Isaiah. But there's a time coming where they also will turn away from God again, and then Babylon will come down and end up destroying Jerusalem and the temple, and they will go into captivity. But isn't this great here where God is talking about this mercy that's coming upon them, that God will bring a Savior to save them, and that they will have release from all this captivity? Well, one, they will get a release from Babylon, but also there's this spiritual release that they will have from their sins and this fruitfulness that is going to go throughout the whole world, not just a small group of people and not this just one little place, but the whole world. And this thing that God has set above everything else, heavenly Jerusalem, heavenly Zion, and being a part of that. Isaiah 61:1. This is Jesus, the first thing he spoke after he had the Holy Spirit and then went and was tempted by the devil, and he came in and opened the scrolls and spoke to the people, and this is what he said. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to those who are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. And that's where Jesus stopped. Now, you notice when he was going along in his ministry, he was also, as he was getting closer to the cross, speaking the other side. And the next line in this says, and the day of vengeance of our God to comfort all who mourn. So there's that acceptable year, that long time, and then the day, which is a short time. So this acceptable year of the Lord, the year of Jubilee, let's look at that, some of the things of it in Leviticus 25. So the sixth year, that's where the land gives fruit enough for 3 years. The seventh year, the land rests. The 49th year, the 10th day of the 7th month, in the Day of Atonement, the sound of trumpet of Jubilee. And the 50th year, all slaves are released, all lands returned to the original family. But, sadly, this wasn't practiced because of greed. And people could practice the things of God, but oftentimes they don't. Since we're speaking of liberty, and we know this is Christ, and he was speaking of himself, let's look at Paul, what he's saying in 2 Corinthians 3:12. Therefore, since we have such hope, we use great boldness of speech, unlike Moses, who put a veil over his face so that the children of Israel could not look steadily at the end of what was passing away, but their minds were blinded. For until this day, the same veil remains unlifted in the reading of the Old Testament, because the veil is taken away in Christ. Well, see, that's it. They were not looking through Christ, and so they are blinded. They can't even tell what the Old Testament is speaking about. And it's the same today. You have rabbis, or you might have Gentiles looking at the Old Testament, and they may come up with their traditions or what they think it's talking about. But unless they look through Christ, they won't even see. They're blind. But even to this day, when Moses is read, a veil lies on their heart. Nevertheless, when one turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom or liberty. But we all, with unveiled face, beholding, as in a mirror, the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. Of course, continuing to speak about captivity, there is those who are trying to bring us into bondage when Jesus has taken us out of it. So Galatians 2:1. Then after 14 years, I went up again to Jerusalem with Barnabas and also took Titus with me. And I went up by revelation and communicated to them that gospel which I preach among the Gentiles, but privately to those who were of reputation, lest by any means I might run or had run in vain. Yet not even Titus, who was with me, being a Greek, was compelled to be circumcised. And this occurred because of false brethren secretly brought in, who came in by stealth to spy out our liberty, which we have in Christ Jesus. Yeah, well, Jesus set us free from the law. He fulfilled the law. It says that they might bring us into bondage. So these people coming in like spies by stealth are trying to bring us back into bondage, to whom we did not yield submission even for an hour. Okay, Paul, Peter, these guys are not cowards when they're looking at this word. They're growing in it and being bold, that the truth of the gospel might continue with you. And let's look at what John says about how Jesus, he comes to destroy the works of the devil. Little children, let no one deceive you. Well, that's great. Yeah, we know there's deception that comes into the body of Christ, but we're not to let them deceive us. He who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed remains in him. And he cannot sin, because he has been born of God. In this, the children of God and the children of the devil are manifest or made apparent. They both shine out of who they are. Whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor is he who does not love his brother. For this is the message that you heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. Not as Cain, who was of the wicked one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his works were evil and his brother's righteous. So the evil doesn't like the works of the righteous, and they try to kill them because they don't want it. They don't want their own works being exposed. Now, this practicing righteousness And those who are born again, they do want to do good. Now, you can be immature and not knowing. You can have poor teaching. Like a lot of the teaching you see in churches, sometimes they're really lukewarm, because Jesus is even confronting churches saying that you are lukewarm, and because you're lukewarm, I spit you out of my mouth. I vomit you out of my mouth. Just like he said in the Old Testament also that that you would be vomited off of the land. He also talks about that. So, you know, now a horse going, I've talked about this before. If a horse is going and it stumbles, of course you're not going to, boom, shoot your horse and it have it worthless. No, if it stumbles, you're going to help it up. But in this is a big thing in general. If someone is continuing to practice sin, well, they probably haven't really turned to God. But there's a difference between practicing something and stumbling. But we'll continue to grow and help each other in love and turn into Christ and grow in Him, because God wants us to be saved, not captives, and continue to grow and what else? Well, just become part of Him and become conformed to His image. All right, let's move on. Okay, back here to Galatians 2:14. But when I saw that they were not straightforward about the truth of the gospel, I said to Peter before them all, if you being a Jew live in the manner of Gentiles and not as the Jews, why do you compel Gentiles to live as Jews? We who are Jews by nature are not sinners of the Gentiles, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Christ Jesus. Even we have believed in Christ Jesus, that we might be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law, for by the works of the law no flesh shall be justified. But if while we seek to be justified by Christ, we ourselves also are found sinners, is Christ therefore a minister of sin? Certainly not. For I build again those things which I destroyed. I make myself a transgressor. For I through the law died to the law that I might live to God. I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God. For if righteousness comes through the law, then Christ died in vain. Well, so Paul's saying a lot there, and he was speaking to Peter because Peter was, you know, those guys that were, they were Jewish. So sometimes they were getting caught about, you know, turning towards this law again. But Paul, who was a Pharisee, I mean, he was a teacher of teachers. He was reminding them, look, we have Christ. He has laid down his life for us. He's the lamb that was slain. Though he did not sin, he was spotless. Our sins are totally wiped out. That's why he died with the sin. We've been crucified with him. Our bodies, they're dead so that we can live in Christ. So where he is, we can be also. So that's great. Paul is really reminding us about what this word is saying and bringing us back to the faith of Abraham, because Abraham was going by faith, looking forward to that city that was not built by hands of man, but God himself was building. Precious stones fit together, all of the people in him, that he does not need a temple anymore. So you are a temple of God when you turn to him, precious stones, as a temple that he would dwell in. All right, now let's look at what Jesus said here in Luke 6:20. And also you see this in Matthew 5. So we're seeing the acceptable year and vengeance. Well, we're kind of seeing that right here with four blessings and four woes. Blessed are you poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. So you see a difference between what they have and what shall they have. Blessed are you who hunger now, for you shall be filled. So theirs is the kingdom of God now, but they shall be filled. They shall laugh, even though they're weeping. Blessed are you when men hate you, and when they exclude you, and revile you, and cast out your name as evil for the Son of Man's sake. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for indeed your reward is great in heaven. for in like manner their fathers did to the prophets. So see, you see those people in the world, they're looking for an earthly reward, a worldly reward, but we have this greater thing in the kingdom of God and in heaven. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full, for you shall hunger. Woe to you who laugh now, for you shall mourn and weep. Woe to you when all men speak well of you, for so did their fathers to the false prophets. You know, people in the world, there's a lot of people suffering now, but they've turned to the Lord. And the world, you know, there's a lot of leaders within the world that they are not doing things according to God, to what His will is. So you can be on whatever country, whatever city, where they're doing quite evil things. They're basically raping the people and taking from them, and they are going without because of these rulers doing wickedly. But God is not that way. He has something saved for you. He's looking out for you, even though you've been going through a lot of suffering. It is very difficult in the world. We have cities in this world that the crime rate is terrible, that people are getting raped every day. People are getting killed every day. People are getting abused. Anything they try to do, people are stealing it. And it's terrible. And politicians, you know, it doesn't matter in a city. You can have politicians in the nation. Both sides can both be doing evil, and nation against nation, causing wars and all this innocent bloodshed that God does not like. And that's where He will have a day of vengeance on these wicked, and they will be paid full up for all the wickedness that they've been doing to other people. All right, let's go on. Isaiah 61:3. To console those who mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes. And this is something because, you know, those, like when Jonah went to Nineveh, those warriors, they actually repented and put ashes on their head and sackcloth instead. So what they were doing was turning back to God, realizing, no, God is right. And they knew what they had done. But many people won't do that. And so what we're getting, this, instead of this ashes on your head, you're getting something beautiful on your head. And that's what God gives for those who repent. The oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they may be called trees of righteousness. And that tree, it means strength, chief, mighty, ram, a pillar, an oak. And the planting of the Lord. So isn't that great that the Lord is really planting this? And Jesus is Lord, that He may be glorified, and they shall rebuild the old ruins, that they shall raise up the former desolations. And when we've seen things talking of being desolate, well, it's when they turn from God. God departs from them because they departed from Him. And they shall repair the ruined cities, the desolation of many generations. And, well, we can think of when Jesus was going to the cross, He said, your house has been made desolate. Jesus says in John 16:20, verily, verily, I say unto you, that ye shall weep and lament, but the world shall rejoice, and ye shall be sorrowful, but your sorrow shall be turned into joy. And then Matthew 5:14, ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. People have turned their back on God, but what does the word say? It says, draw near to me and I'll draw near to you. And so then we've got these times when God has come working with the people, but that's what they've done. They've turned their back on God, but He continues to be there, and He has continued to do things, you know, like with Hosea. He had him go after a harlot to show them, look, you've been a harlot to me, but I'm still going after, but you still turn away. And so I'm going to turn away from you. And then the destruction that you've been putting on others is going to come on you yourself. So, all right, let's look at Acts 13. And we're looking at the persecution from Jews, but the disciples filled with joy and the Holy Spirit. On the next Sabbath, almost the whole city came together to hear the word of God. But when the Jews saw the multitudes, they were filled with envy, and contradicting and blaspheming, they opposed the things spoken by Paul. Then Paul and Barnabas grew bold and said, it was necessary that the word of God should be spoken to you first. But since you reject it and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, behold, we turn to the Gentiles. For so the Lord has commanded us, I have set you as a light to the Gentiles, that you should be for salvation to the ends of the earth. So he's reciting Isaiah 49 when he's speaking of that and telling us about exactly what he's talking about. This mercy of God is going out to the whole world. Now when the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and they glorified the word of the Lord. And as many as had been appointed to eternal life believed. And the word of the Lord was being spread throughout all the region. But the Jews stirred up devout and prominent women. Wow, that's crazy. See, in the world we still have things like that, that people will take advantage of others and stir them up to do evil. And the chief men of the city also. They raised up persecution against Paul and Barnabas and expelled them from their region. So that's why we don't want to be partakers of deception, because there are men really trying to deceive others to do evil. But they shook off the dust from their feet against them and came to Iconium, and the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. Jesus, he is also calling people to repent. And here's a good example of it in Matthew 11:20. Then he began to rebuke the cities in which most of his mighty works had been done, because they did not repent. So, wow, that's amazing. He's rebuking cities. Woe to you, Chorazin. Woe to you, Bethsaida. For if the mighty works which were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I say to you, it will be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon in the day of judgment than for you. And you, Capernaum, who are exalted to heaven, will be brought down to Hades. We see the day of judgment that we saw in Isaiah 61 there, and of course, sackcloth and ashes. For if the mighty works which were done in you had been done in Sodom, it would have remained until this day. But I say to you that it shall be more tolerable for the land of Sodom in the day of judgment than for you. And back to Isaiah 61:5. Now I have 2 Corinthians here because they're rejoicing. They're rejoicing in this thing with Paul, as also ye have acknowledged us in part that we are your rejoicing. So they're really happy to have Paul and Peter and the other teachers, Timothy, Titus, to help them along, and Barnabas, to show them the truth so they can be set free from captivity. And then even as ye also are ours in the day of the Lord Jesus. So Paul's also looking forward to this joy of these believers coming into Christ. Strangers shall stand and feed your flocks, and the sons of the foreigner shall be your plowmen and your vine dressers. So look at this, sons of foreigners, and what are they doing? They're things that are working towards a harvest. But you shall be named the priests of the Lord. They shall call you the servants of our God. You shall eat the riches of the Gentiles. And I was looking in some commentaries where the strength, riches, strength of a tree is its fruit. You know how believers are fruitful. And in their glory you shall boast. And that's where I was referencing 2 Corinthians there. Instead of your shame, you shall have double honor. And instead of confusion, they shall rejoice in their portion. Therefore, in their land, they shall possess double. Now, their land, well, we have a heavenly Jerusalem, heavenly Zion, and not just this little tiny earthly portion, because the meek will inherit the whole earth, not just a small portion. Everlasting joy shall be theirs. And 1 Corinthians 15:58. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. And let's finish this part off with Ephesians 4:11. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints. And the saints, of course, that's the believers, for the work of ministry, for the edifying or building up of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro, and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and the cunning craftiness, whereby they live in wait to deceive. Wow, that's so big that we need to watch for that deception and those false doctrines and the craftiness and men. Wow, the sleight of men, that's huge to look at. But speaking the truth in love, and that's what Paul, Peter, John, James, Stephen, all these men were doing, was speaking the truth in love, because they had love for Jews and Gentiles to be set free from captivity, that they may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. This I say therefore, and testify in the Lord, that ye henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk, in the vanity of their mind. Vanity means emptiness. So they're walking around in the emptiness of their mind, having the understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God through the ignorance that is in them because of the blindness of their heart. So see, here we have Jews and Gentiles both blind in the heart, not looking to Christ, the Messiah that Moses and the prophets were speaking of. And then 19, who being past feeling have given themselves over unto lasciviousness to work all uncleanness with greediness. And that word lasciviousness, looseness, irregular indulgence of animal desires, wantonness, lustfulness, tendency to excite lust and promote irregular indulgence. Way out of order there. So let's look at the word wanton, because I wasn't sure what that meant. Merciless, inhumane, wanton cruelty, having no just foundation or provocation, malicious, a wanton attack, being without check or limitation, such as unduly lavish, extravagant, wanton imagination. Wow, even just an imagination. And that reminds you of what Christ said, you know, if we're doing this stuff in our hearts, we've already committed the deed. Luxuriantly rank, wanton vegetation. I'm not sure exactly what that means. Lewd body, causing sexual excitement. Lustful, sensual, playfully mean or cruel. Mischievous, hard to control, undisciplined, and unruly. Well, that's a lot to look at in that first part of Isaiah 61. And yeah, it just goes to show you how much the world needs to be set free from their captivity, that captivity of sin. And there is no freedom in that. And it is cruel. People are very cruel in the world. There are wicked. But just like, remember, Daniel's friends got thrown into the fire, but God saved them from the fire. Daniel got thrown into the pit, but God saved him from the pit. Men actually do these cruel things, but we have a God. We have a Lord. Thank God that he had set this, that God has a purpose for us to continue to walk in him and grow in him and be faithful until the end. And he gives us the help by the Holy Spirit so that we can do that and to continue to love God, love others, and do good, and have the help and the power of the Holy Spirit to do it. So God bless you to continue in him, in the name of Jesus. Amen.